Good evening and welcome to the Midland Board of Education regularly scheduled meeting on December 12, 2011. Madam Secretary, would you call roll?
I would be happy to. President Maltz.
Here.
Vice President Wasserman is absent tonight. Secretary Rouse is here. Treasurer Oley.
Here.
Member Baker.
Here.
Member Branstad.
Here.
And Member Kaminsky.
Here.
We have a quorum.
Thank you very much. We have a very short consent agenda with respect to the last meeting. Is there anything that anybody would like removed prior to approving the consent agenda? Hearing none, we'll move forward with the consent agenda, which starts with 2.1, the approval of the regular minutes from the Monday, November 28th meeting. 2.2 is the following staff members have announced their resignations, effective date indicated. And 3.3, which is the authorization of the following legal bills for the district, which is the last item on our consent agenda. Board's pleasure.
Move approval of items 2.1 through 3.3.
Support.
Moved by Mr. Oley, supported by Dr. Kaminsky. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
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 Opposed, same sign. Motion carries. Request to address the board. Is there anyone in our viewing audience who would like to come to the podium, state their name, address, and affiliation? If not, okay.
All right.
The mic probably needs to be turned down, Carol, and Cindy can help you with that if you.
Hello. I'm here with friends, family, and neighbors of Lee Rouse, and we would like to express our appreciation to Lee for her several years of service to the schools here in Midland County, in the city of Midland, and how she's represented us so well and how we are so proud of her and her service. It's a very thankless job. Sometimes you don't get the credit that you need, but tonight we are going to say thank you, Lee.
Thank you.
Anyone else would like to come to the podium at this time and
I think you all should come up like one at a time.
No.
We can have her in tears before we're done. No, just kidding. Anyone else from the audience? If not, we'll close the request to address the board at this time and move into our presentations to the Board of Education Matters. And I will defer the next recommended for action item on the agenda to our treasurer, Mr. Oley.
Thank you, Ken. It is my honor to read a resolution, which I'm a little nervous of in front of the throngs of friends, family, and neighbors that are here. Anyways, I'd be happy to do this. It's a resolution recognizing the contribution of Ms. Lee Rouse to the education of children at Midland Public Schools, Midland, Michigan. Whereas Ms. Lee Rouse has served on the Midland Public Schools Board of Education from 2003 through 2011. Whereas during her tenure on the Midland Public Schools Board of Education, Ms. Rouse served as board president for 2 years, vice president for 2 years, and secretary for 1 year. Whereas Ms. Rouse has served on numerous boards and committees during her term with the Midland Public Schools Board of Education, adding significant views and insights as topics were discussed, recommendations were formulated, and decisions were made. Whereas throughout her years of service, Ms. Rouse has made an invaluable contribution to education in Midland, Michigan, always focusing on the best interest of all students. Therefore, be it resolved, the Midland Public Schools Board of Education formally recognizes Ms. Lee Rouse for her 8 years of dedicated service to the children of Midland Public Schools through her dedicated service on the Midland Public Schools Board of Education, dated this 12th day of December 2001, Ken Malt, Board of Education President, and Rick Oley, Board of Education Treasurer.
Thank you, guys.
Madam Secretary.
Okay, we sit down now.
And there's a party at the Rouse House afterwards.
I hope the Rouse kids cleaned the house then, because I just left it. I just want to say thank you to everybody. I'm not often found speechless, and I'm completely stunned and speechless right now, I admit. It's been, I couldn't believe this morning when I was thinking about it, over 8 years. It's been a long time, and I know it's been a rough road for a lot of us being on the board. And I so much appreciate my family and friends because they've supported me so much through all of this because it has been rough at times. But I appreciate all of you too, all you fellow board members and staff members. And I still believe that Midland Public Schools is one of the best districts in the state of Michigan. I think most of us see proof of that every day when we look at the kids in our homes and away at college and in jobs. And I look forward to being able to volunteer in a different capacity. So I don't think you'll see me too far away for sure, because we're so involved in the schools anyway. So it'll give me an opportunity to do some fun things as well. So I wish all of you the best. I wish the school system the best, and hope that things become a little bit more stable in the future, and our newcomers will have an easy path as they come aboard. I know you're all in good hands, so thank you. And thank you guys for coming. It was so nice to see all these smiling, happy faces. Appreciate it.
Okay, before we lose some of our audience members, and I understand if you leave, the rest of this is not as exciting as what we've had. And so with that, I'd entertain any comments that our board might have at this time. Mr. Oley.
You know, I've seen a lot of board members come and go over my tenure on the board, and we've been blessed with wonderful board members. But I don't often say that not everybody fits in this category, as good as our board members have been, but Lee is a Hall of Fame board member. And I think that comes with a vantage point of sitting next to her for 8 years and seeing her on a lot of committees, seeing her out in the community, always representing Midland Public Schools. And I think, you know, oftentimes I think about, so what are those characteristics that apply best to Lee? Or, you know, in the past, we've certainly had some wonderful board members too. And they usually come up with two or three things that really just stand out and say, that's Lee. And I struggled because I came up with like 10 that all apply to her. And I think that says something about the balance that she provides, about the depth and the breadth of her view, her perspective, her vantage point, her contribution. Here are just some words, and these, every one of them apply, and I don't know which one's at the top. I think they're all equal. Lee has provided wisdom, creativity, perseverance, which we all need to have in this role, courage to speak her mind, to say what she thinks is right and stand by her convictions, integrity, tell the truth as she sees it, as we all see it, professionalism, showing respect for everybody that's come before us, that she interacts with. And she's a wonderful, wonderful listener. And with that listening comes this great level of compassion, that even though we have to make tough decisions up here, and sometimes not everybody is happy about the decisions we make or the discussions that we even have, she's always done it with fairness and compassion and sensitivity, and always keeping all the people, but most importantly, the students, in the forefront of everything. So those are kind of my thoughts for Lee. Okay. So thank you.
And now you know why I had our Rick go first. Anyone else would like to?
I do, Ken.
Yes.
I first knew Lee as a mom and a volunteer. And so when you were running for the school board, I knew that we were going to have a gem on the board with us. And kind of echoes a little bit of what Rick said, that you've led us with such integrity and honesty and compassion, and you're always visible. You're available to all of us and to everybody all the time. And you've led us through probably what I would say was the most difficult years in my 11 years on the board. So it's been an honor to serve alongside you. And I am proud to call you a fellow board member, but mostly a friend. So thank you. It's not enough. And I wish you all the best. And we know we'll see you. As you said, you'll still be volunteering and around, and we know we'll see at school and in the community. Thank you. So thanks, Lee. We'll miss you.
Well, I'm not going to pass on this opportunity, and that's to be expected. And most people know me well enough that I'm going to do it now because I don't want to lose anybody in the audience. Rob and your daughters know just how tough Lee Rouse can be. And so do the rest of us sitting on the board. Because when the chips are down and things need to get done and we need to hold our positions and do the tough things that aren't always the most popular things, this lady is nothing but stellar. And it goes to all 10 items that Mr. Oley said, talked about a moment ago as to her character. And I'm finishing or into my eighth year on the board. And you can take a lot of guidance from this lady sitting to my left. And so I'm proud to say that we've not only shared our position on the board, but occasionally for many years on the soccer field and other places. And I'm very proud, as Lynn and Rick and others have said, that I can call her my friend. And I'm very proud of the fact that she's done so much for this district to enable it to continue in its excellence as we move into the future. And just rest assured, she's left us in good hands. So thank you.
Thank you, Ken.
Anybody else? I'm going to hold off until the end. Okay. Well, with that, we'll move on to the not-so-exciting school board issues. So with that, I'll move to Mr. Ellinger for superintendent's report, please.
Just a couple of comments, excuse me, related to Lee as well. I weren't sure that I was waiting for the rest of the board to talk Ken or to make sure they were given the opportunity to. Two things I would say about Lee, two quick stories. One, nothing is more important to a superintendent than to have a board president who can be flexible on their schedule. And many of us know that when Lee is in Midland, and she travels a lot with her job, even when she was on the road, she was readily accessible to me if I needed to call her on the phone. There's much more contact between the superintendent on behalf of all of the folks here to my left and the board president than there is any other single board member during any year. It doesn't matter which one it is. You were always accessible, and your guidance was appreciated from my point of view. Two, not everybody who would even like to give up that kind of time feels that they can do it, because most of these board members are working outside the home, and they're very busy people. That applies to all seven of them. I can't imagine how much lost productivity or lost income that her company really might have gained if she hadn't been as dedicated as she is to MPS. And you want to remember, all seven of these board members do this without remuneration. They could at their organizational meeting elect to pay themselves. There are other elected bodies in the area that do, but this Board of Education does it for free. And they only do that for one reason, because they're really dedicated to children, and Lee's at the top of the echelon when it comes to knowing what that really means. And I think her family pays the price. So thank you again to the Rouse family for allowing her to serve. The last thing I would mention is this. One thing that's very unique about Lee, maybe more so than any other person that sits at this table, is her ability to facilitate discussions. It's what she does for work in large measure. It's a skill set that she has. And I want to thank you for bringing that to the table on behalf of the Board of Education. The decisions and the processes that we had to follow are better decisions, and they were stronger processes because of how you often led us through that. So I want to personally thank you for it.
Thank you, Carl.
Okay, with that, let's get into the superintendent's report. That will be very brief, because there's just two items of legislative action that I want to draw to the board and the public's attention. The first one is, you may have heard last week that the governor has officially signed legislation dealing with anti-bullying, with the bullying that can go on in any school district in the state of Michigan. There are some pretty big implications for schools in terms of how we inform the family of someone who's been bullied, as well as how we engage the family of the person doing the bullying. That will imply some changes for us. In some ways it won't. We do those things in the past. We have 6 months with which to develop board policy that's related to this. We will bring that to the board, and we have to solicit public input to make sure that they understand what it is that we're doing. On the other hand, the flip side of this is that none of this is really news to us, that for those of us that have been educators in recent years. And I'll just use this as one example. Every single elementary building here in this district did some kind of an assembly related to bullying last year. And we have some elementaries, a couple of them, that have adopted national bullying programs with the help of a couple of foundations here in the community with some significant dollars associated with that, so they can take that bullying campaign to their students and follow through on it. So we have language in our secondary handbooks, especially at the high school level, that deal with bullying. But we will certainly be in compliance, and any changes we have to make, we will bring in policy recommendations to the Board of Education. The second policy change, I don't think we talked about this 2 weeks ago, is that the governor has also signed off on language. So even though our board a year ago decided to go with annual November elections and save the cost of running a May election, when perhaps the school election was the only thing on the ballot, now the law has changed, and local school boards can only hold elections for school board members on November of even years. And so that's going to be a big change for us, and that means that there will be an extension of terms for board members who may have been up in November of an odd year. We will deal with all of that and announce a little more detail about what that means in our January organizational meeting, which is, I believe it's 4 p.m. in the afternoon on January the 9th. Two significant changes. For right now, at least for the next 2 or 3 weeks, we hope that's all the changes legislatively that the Lansing has for us that would impact local education. But we will be keeping our eye on those two particular items. And with that, I'm going to keep the superintendent's report rather brief, because I think our next two items will occupy a fair amount of our conversation tonight.
Correct. Thank you. We asked Carl to present property management plan recommendations to us. This is a report on that same issue. It's yet to be decided whether or not it's an actionable item or an informational piece at this meeting this evening. So let's listen to the report and see what we prefer to do and going from there.
I think the board members have a written copy of this before you, so you may want to have that in front of you. That offers a bit more detail than this PowerPoint, but the PowerPoint comes directly off of this. And I apologize ahead of time to our viewing audience, because I don't think everything we're going to show on this screen will necessarily be easily viewed on TV. But it's important information, so I'll review as much of it verbally as I can. We started talking to the board back in October, showing some data points to the board in terms of what the building capacities are in all our buildings and property management in terms of property that we had that we sold this year, what would we like to do with property in the future that we will allude to at the end of this 19-slide presentation. And then we have had a couple of meetings in a row with our finance study committee where we've dug into the detail of this. And so what I'm bringing you is at the recommendation and the support of the FFO study committee of the board. As presented to the board back in October the 4th, the property management plan looked at building capacities, varied grade level configurations, and different building models and scenarios that would look into the future. This followed up on the work of the building closure committee that took place 2 winters ago in preparation for shutting down 5 of our 12 elementary buildings prior to this past school year. The overview tonight will take that document one step further and provide future uses and possible plans for district buildings. And it is presented to the board as a recommendation. Our thinking is you would act on that in January at your January 9th meeting. But if you decide to act on it tonight, that will be your decision. This property management plan would require input from at least the Board of Education's Finance, Facilities, and Operations Study Committee. Additional input may be sought from the full Board of Education or others at the direction of the Study Committee or by Board of Education action. While this plan does not create benchmark pathways for decision making that's based on enrollment minimums or financial stability, it's not that those things aren't important, of our school district, but it does address the reasonable anticipated programmatic needs of our students on a timeline through the years 2019 and 20, which would be for the next 8-year period. It's our recommendation not to base a property management plan strictly on student enrollment or projections of district finances due to the tremendous challenges and inaccuracies of such data, frankly, beyond a 3-year period, as we have discovered in the last 5 or 7 years of this business. But anything beyond 3 years, we have to be really careful of relying on that as a solid number, just because the foundation of how public schools are financed is that soft, and it can change based on the whims of Lansing and due to economics in the state of Michigan and how the school aid fund is used. Traditionally, you could always count on it being used for K through 12 education. And this past year was the first time the governor allowed some of that money to be used to support community colleges. To do otherwise would accomplish two unintended outcomes that I think we would like to avoid. One, it could potentially unduly panic our parents and community over future consolidations and/or building closures, which would be far too close to the most recent elementary building consolidation experience. And two, base future long-term property decisions on financial data that is at best soft when projected out for longer than 3 years, like I mentioned. This is especially true when it comes to predicting future revenues for public schools, really across the state, not just here in Midland. So MPS administration offers the following as our current guidance on property management for our students, our staff, and our larger Midland community. Elementary building recommendations. You see the five that are listed there: Adams Elementary School, Chestnut Hill Elementary School, Plymouth Elementary School, Siebert, and Woodcrest Elementary Schools. We would anticipate these buildings remaining open and maintained as grade K through 5 elementary school buildings for future years, at least through that 8-year period. Given the likely scenario that the legislature is going to require full-time kindergarten within a year or two, we know these elementary buildings have the capacity to handle full-day kindergarten. When you look at Carpenter and Eastlawn Elementary, which is what the next couple of slides are about, we only separated those out for focus in this plan because those were the two buildings that the building closure committee looked at, potentially consolidated either at Central Middle School or in some other configuration. They didn't consider that beyond the five that we have closed already. That received serious consideration anyway. Carpenter Elementary School was built in 1926, which makes it the MPS oldest elementary school building. To close Carpenter and disperse the students throughout the other buildings this coming school year in 12 and 13 would put elementary buildings at almost 93% capacity, and in the 13-14 school year, capacity would be at 90%. Of course, these capacity numbers will change with the addition of full-day kindergarten, which you're going to see is the next agenda item that we deal with this evening. This model would require further scrutiny as new elementary boundary lines would need to be drawn, and the potentiality of asking families of the five closed buildings to again move to an elementary school, different elementary school, after only 2 years, we think needs to be looked at for cost savings versus district welfare. The recommendation, therefore, is to leave Carpenter as an elementary building, again, for the next 8-year period, at least, as a K through 5 building. You'll see similarities in what we're suggesting to you for Eastlawn Elementary School. It's the second oldest elementary building, being built in 1954. To close it, disperse the students through the other buildings for next year would put the elementary buildings at 97% capacity. And the 13-14 would have capacity at almost 95%. Of course, those numbers changing again with consideration for full-day kindergarten. This model, same as the Carpenter model, would require examining boundary lines, again with the same caution of we'd want to be careful of doing that and creating some unnecessary panic amongst our community if this was considered by the Board of Ed. Additionally, as a side note, the additional administrative staffing may be required if Eastlawn continues with its current percent of Title I students. Our recommendation is to leave Eastlawn Elementary as a K through 5 elementary building. When you look at the middle school buildings, it's a bit of a different story, of course. Jefferson is the newest middle school. It was built in 1963. We do not recommend closing Jefferson because of its age, its proximity to Siebert Elementary School, which would preserve long-term additional options if the district needs to go down that path, and given its location in the city of Midland. The same would apply to Northeast. It was built in 1950. We do not recommend closing Northeast, again, because of its age, proximity to an elementary campus, and its location in the city. I'll let you know, because we were going to have public discussion of this, I spent about an hour and 15 minutes after school today with our Central Middle School staff because I knew they would be curious about what was going to be discussed. Mr. Poole's in the back of our audience here tonight. He was also there for that meeting. And it was a very good meeting with the Central Middle School staff. They are very concerned about the welfare of the students in that building. And we didn't do any voting in this meeting, but my guess is there are some folks on that staff that are very strong proponents for not closing Central, but continuing to run with it the way that we have. And there are others that would say, no, if we close Central as a middle school, not that we wouldn't use it for other purposes, let's make that decision. Let's get on with it. It's been discussed about, as I found out from some of the veteran staff members there, that option has been discussed in this community, according to the staff, for 26 years. Central Middle School is the second oldest building in the district. It was built in 1937. The school could be closed as a middle school, but still heated and used for other purposes as early as this coming fall for the 12-13 year, which would put the other two middle schools at almost 93% capacity, but only if using most classrooms for each period of the day. What that would mean is that a majority of teaching staff in those buildings would not have their classroom available to them when their students were out for specials classes, and so they would have to go elsewhere in the building for their conference and prep. That's not popular with teachers. I'll tell you, I was a middle school teacher for a number of years, and it was early in my career. I always had to do that for part of the time, but as a building principal.
83 or 93?
83.
83, okay.
Right. And that's not an easy thing to ask a teacher to do. It's a convenience to have that where all your resources are when you do your planning. But it, there are some schools where it's a more common practice than it is here in Midland. If we're using the enrollment figures across the district as the only consideration, it could be done in 12-13. However, the following factors need to be considered before the closure of Central Middle School can take place. For example, does Northeast and Jefferson have room for two additional self-contained special education classrooms necessary to accommodate the CMS special education students? Two, will the middle school feeder schools need to change? For example, Adams and or high school boundary lines need to be redrawn to accommodate the Central students and the two other buildings. And if so, this is problematic for our IS system department right now because we have temporary staffing levels that we've had for just about a year there, although we are close to making some hiring decisions in that department. We need time to determine if current high school boundaries continue to be used. Does the closure of Central affect current and future school of choice options for parents and students? It may be necessary to ask current school of choice middle school students to return to their home middle school, which could also alter the high school they will attend. So this particular school of choice and how we would define who attends which of the two other schools is a sensitive issue for us, and I think it will be for our community as well. I think we need to have discussion by you, by the whole board, regarding the closure of Central that could include the following. It may be more prudent to announce the closure of CMS for the fall of 2013 and not 12. Keep the current 6th and 7th graders for the 12-13 year and allow the current 5th graders to transfer to Jefferson and Northeast Middle School. Of course, doing that would lessen the number of students that would be at Central, and it would be almost a guarantee we'd have to lock in some parents there because you could see a mass exodus of people saying, why do I only want to stay here for one more year? And we don't want to overcrowd the other two buildings by making this decision for the 12-13 school year. Why would we close Central? To save money. Note, we may not actually save all the $500,000 annually that was identified by the building closure committee if additional administrators, counselors, programs, etc. are determined to be needed to make a successful transition for those CMS students to Jefferson and to Northeast. Programmatically, is it the right thing to do to provide more equitable opportunities for students? We have to ask ourselves that question. We had kind of an interesting discussion today with staff that if you're a student at CMS and you want to take some language, you can do it on the front end or the tail end of the day by going to one of the high schools, and then we return kids back to Central. They can have access pretty much to the same curriculum that the other two middle schools are offered. That's not true in all the areas of music, but it's delivered to them differently than it is at Jefferson at Northeast, and I don't think that's a surprise to too many of our board members here. What to do with the building once closed as a middle school, given the auditorium and the location of the building? I will tell you, in my 4.5 years of being part of the district, there is not an easy answer to this question. I think it was in 1999 that there was a community fundraiser that allowed renovation to take place in the auditorium to the tune of $2 million, if I recall correctly. We could move East Lawn and Carpenter students into the building, but do the costs involved warrant this possibility? An architect would have to be hired, and renovation costs would have to be considered to restructure the building for different student base. For example, if you have kindergarten students in that building, they must be on the first floor with a bathroom attached to their classroom by school code. So that's going to eck into cost if the board were to consider that as an option. You could look at a closed middle school, but still using the auditorium as a location for some kind of a magnet school or a special school. And if Midland Public Schools happens to go down the path of a new tech site, although a better possibility, we think, would be the Parkdale Elementary attached to the Midland High campus, we could entertain the idea of housing a program if we go down this path at the central site. You could charter a high school, a magnet school, a specialized program. That may pose more questions than solutions. We could launch a community committee to study future potential uses of CMS. That idea seemed to gain favor with the FFO when we talked about it a couple of weeks ago. If you had the right people from this community on a committee that would have say, how could we join with, for example, the Center for the Arts or other agencies? What could we do to make good use of the square footage in that building? That may be worth putting a community committee together for. There may be other ideas that we haven't explored here the board members may have that you would like to give credence to this evening. But our recommendation is that we close Central Middle School, that we not do it in the fall of 2012, that we do it for the 12-13 school year, and that if we were to do a community committee, we get that committee up and running not this spring when we're preparing, wrapping up this year's budget and developing next year's budget, but we do it like we did with the building closure committee, started in the summer, and have the lion's share of that work out for a recommendation to the board for potential future uses whenever they're ready. There's no timeline that's pushing the hard recommendation that might come for how we use that building. But it would be difficult for us to find the time to do that this spring. Moving on to Dow High School, it was built in 1967. It's been suggested by some community members to explore the feasibility of making the H.H. Dow High the MPS Middle School campus. As enrollment projections were considered, the soonest we could consider moving the middle school program into Dow High School is 2016, which would put this building at 99% capacity. And I can tell you from having been a middle school principal for 9 years of my career, that is a bad idea. All of us should think back to what we went through when we were between 10 and 14, and to jam that many students into a building that was never designed for a middle school, and there are unique needs that middle school students have, at that level of capacity is going to create as many problems as it's going to solve. For educational reasons, we do not recommend the move of the middle school program into this building. We anticipate this building remaining open and maintained as a high school building for the future years. Future years meaning at least 8, if not more, as reference to the recommendations for the other buildings. Midland High, built in 1955. It's been suggested to explore the feasibility of making Midland High in Parkdale as the only Midland High School campus here in Midland. As enrollment projections were considered, again, the soonest we could consider moving that campus model into place would be in 2016, which would put that campus at 93% capacity. That's pretty high capacity for a high school that needs a lot of flexibility with how they work with programming for their students. For educational reasons, we are not recommending this high school campus model. Most educational research would actually suggest that the ideal size for a high school is 800 students or less. We're well beyond that when we're running those high schools at 1,500 and 1,600 students. And I would dare say that most of us in this room probably know a high school student, good as we are in our high schools, that know that just given their size, that tends to isolate a few students. Even some of our students could probably verify that for you. We anticipate keeping this building open and maintained as a high school building for future years. And if you take a look for a future proposal for a Midland High School campus, we could consider the option of preparing the Parkdale Elementary building for becoming a new tech high school program. I don't know how we could really make that a reality without the help of a sinking fund at some point in time in the district, continue the upkeep on our facilities, but talk to our community about why having a new tech type program would be a good alternative and a good way to engage students, high school students here in Midland, but we continue to explore that. We think if we were to go down this path, it would require an investment of about $2.5 to $3 million for infrastructure and technology. It would require additional administrative costs, but likely less than $160,000 total cost. And then we'd be in the business of attracting a freshman class cohort of about 100 students drawn from both Midland High School and Dow High School. And then over 4 years, the program size could potentially grow to be 400 students. A program like that with proper funding and renovations in place could open in the fall of 2013, depending upon funding options. And let's be clear, if something like that were a serious consideration here, it would take funding options beyond what our school board has at its disposal currently. The Ashman Science Center building, after having multiple uses, the building is currently being used as the district science center, and given its room configuration and available storage, we would recommend continuing this very purposeful use. Annualizing utility cost over there, you can see what they are. Natural gas, $8,500, electricity, a little over $6,000. Water and sewer, around $1,000. There's about $15,000 in annual utility cost associated with operating that building. If we were to consolidate middle schools and close Central Middle School for educational purposes at some time, we could also close the Ashman building as an option for the board to look at. However, it's unlikely that such a move would actually increase the utility cost for CMS to the point where that $16,000 annual cost of saved utilities at Ashman could actually be absorbed by the actual move and accompanying utility cost increases at Central. Therefore, we recommend keeping the Ashman building open until a broader plan for use of Central Middle School is developed that might offset the increased utility costs. When you look at the admin center here, the building that we're in, we recommend maintaining the administrative center for its current purpose. All special services support staff, storage, and workspace for auxiliary services are currently housed in this location with the closure of the State Street building next door. Space utilization is optimized currently in this building. I remember early when I joined the district, people I would hear out in the community say, you should go down to the admin building because you could shoot a gun off and you wouldn't hit anything. And there were few people here in this building at that point in time. But when we consolidated the State Street with this, you would be surprised. And I would invite you to come in and tour the building to see how packed this building is currently and how we're using space. Efficiency is actually decreased once the decision is made to move this complex by any remodeling, rewiring, and office space preparation needed by moving the administrative center, for example, to Central Middle School. Additionally, with investments in technology from recent years, we feel it prudent that this investment better serves the district from the administration center versus relocation costs associated with movement of this building's operation to CMS. Other less defined efficiencies would be lost by moving the administration center when one realizes the efficient operations where their current location, when it comes to the work, the shared staff, just the business of running the school district that takes place between admin here, transportation next door, and building and grounds, which is right across the street as well. Here's a status report on our vacant property. On Perrin Road, we have 20 acres. It is mostly wetlands. It's developable property, really has minimum value. We've had lots of discussions. This is not directly across the road from Cook, but a little bit south of that. I think part of that property is across from the old Cook Elementary School. Not a lot of useful property with value there. Then at 4203 Main Street, adjacent to Dow High School, there's some property, I forget, Linda, help me out, the business that's there that we sold the property rights to? Deer Run, some of you may know where Deer Run is on Main Street. It's property directly to the west, a little bit south of that. It would be south and a little east of the high school. Because of that property's proximity to Dow High School, sale of the property is not recommended. It was originally acquired for the purpose of an additional elementary school quite some number of years in the past. Then we have property on North Jefferson. There was a 2011 purchase agreement that fell through due to the lack of guaranteed city services. I think that's where our old alternative education building used to be, if that would help some of you place that property. And then on East Letts Road, probably not that many people know where this is, there are 68 acres. The property was originally acquired to accommodate undefined future school buildings as Midland population increased. The property was actually acquired when student population here was over 12,000. And now we have over 8,000. The recommendation from administration is to keep the current property with no plans to sell at the present time, specifically that Letts Road property, because the property is likely to have more value in the future than it does right now in this kind of economic condition in the state of Michigan. Properties that were sold in 2011, you can see the Sylvan Lane, Tanwood Court, and the Mainstein property, as well as the Chippewa Elementary school building. Those deals have been sold, closed. They no longer belong to Midland Public Schools. And properties with purchase orders pending but not yet closed are the properties on Sylvan Lane and Foster Road, and we're optimistic that those deals will close here in the next few weeks. So that's our property management plan as we worked on it with the FFO Study Committee, and with that, I turn it back to you, Mr. Malt.
Thank you. And thanks for a very detailed report, Carl. I know a lot of work went into that along with the FFO discussion. Dr. Kaminsky.
I also wanted to say thanks. I mean, the time that went into that took a number of months to develop, and Carl, you put a lot of time into that, our administrative leaders and also the educators. It's nice to have some recommendations that are detailed as far as a plan for the future. I know it makes us a little bit nervous as board members trying to put all that, it's like, what would we do? It's good to have the recommendations there. And also, I think parents out there really do need to have something to put their arms around and have some finality if they're looking at equipment for schools, uniforms, things like that. So I just felt the need was out there. So I appreciate all the work that went into that, FFO, administrators, educators.
Anybody else this time?
No, I think you did a really nice job summarizing. I mean, we've had hours and hours of discussion, obviously, just FFO, and they've spent much more time than that in preparing and analyzing and providing alternatives and options, and we had it's important stuff for us long-term, and we all know that there's been a whole lot of rumors that have been buzzing around for, quite frankly, years of people that have jumped to conclusions for a variety of reasons about what's going to close and what's going to be here, and I think it's important that we are as transparent as possible about the discussions taking place, both in terms of buildings that we feel need to stay as they are, as well as the Central Middle School thing. And I was glad to hear that, the staff, I think, who we have to be very sensitive to, as well as the parents and people living in those neighborhoods and the students. I think it's important that we just get that out and let them know that we're actively thinking along those lines. And I know there's a timing issue that I think we need to have some good dialogue about, because I think there's advantages both ways. But I think it's important that we get it out on the table so everybody knows kind of what we think is in store for us on the road. So I think you did a nice job.
Thanks. So.
Anyone else? I'll just add to that by saying that I would caution the board in recommending a full committee to continue to look at options for Central. I think that if we form a committee, it's for with the recommendation that Carl has put forth this evening, and that's looking at alternative suggestions with respect to what that building could be used for. But I'm pleased with the outcome and suggestion that and recommendation by the administration on the current schedule for Central Middle School. And we can have time to digest what we've had in front of us this evening, or we can take action this evening. It's the board's pleasure. I think that myself personally, and speaking for myself only at this time, I would like to have at least until the next meeting to decide how we want to proceed based on an actionable item. So,
yeah, I would agree with that. I don't think we should take action. I'd like to get some input relative to the timing issue. Mm-hmm. What makes most sense, next year, the following, there's a lot of work that has to be done regardless of when that is, but I think you point out some really good things about what could happen if you have more time.
Right.
People are going to be making decisions that may not, be adding to the value of the educational experience in Central, but it could work the opposite way too, and I'd like to have some more input from people and discussion and reactions, I guess, from folks here.
Well, and I like, in addition to that, I like the idea that Mr. Poole can go back to his staff and his student body and tell them that business as usual, and that we will be looking at that use. And I was amazed at the number of years that that building's been looked at. I got a little bit of an education this evening on 20-some years plus. We will not take action on that item or any of this tonight, and wait for further review and recommendation.
And the only other comment I just want to make, I guess, that, you know, all of us, none of us have a clear crystal ball, and obviously it gets very hazy as we get beyond, you know, 2 or 3 years. I personally am very comfortable in feeling that, you know, those recommendations that are out there are good, solid for 5 years. When you get beyond 5 years and we go to 7, 8 years, it really gets hazy for me, and I would like, not knowing what would happen relative to enrollment and revenue streams and all that other stuff, I don't know that I could sit here and predict that and guarantee, if you will, that, yep, things are going to stay status quo for 8 years or whatever the number is. I don't know what the right year is. I just know that given our the turmoil that we've had for many years, that seems to be a long time out to be able to predict that our situation won't change.
That's correct.
So, anyways.
That's good advice, yeah. Rick, because frequently boards of school districts struggle with trying to obligate with, you know, finite definitions. Mm-hmm. Future boards.
Yeah,
so right. I think it's astute of you to mention that.
Yeah.
Thank you. Anything else on this matter? Well, thank you again, Carl. Moving on to 5.4, which is kind of a exciting recommendation, Dr. Ellison. I think, anyway, this is just me. 2012-13 full-day kindergarten recommendation, Dr. Ellison.
Yes, actually, a lot of what you were talking about was that we've been talking about this for years, a lot of rumors have. All of that could just be repeated one more time, because a lot of it would be the same kind of thing. But I am bringing you to you this evening a recommendation to extend our half-day program to a full-day program. As you know, for the past several years, the legislators have brought forth intent legislation that says that if you have a half-day kindergarten program, you would get half an FTE pupil allowance for the funding. And people have been concerned about that. You read about it in the newspapers. And we have thoughtfully examined that for several years. And this year, we have decided to bring forth the recommendation to you and just say, let's go forward, because there are lots of good reasons to do that. By waiting, when the legislators say that there is intent for several years in a row, and we're hearing that they plan to do that, by waiting, we put our parents at a disadvantage. They can't make decisions. We can't make decisions. We're trying to move forward and plan next year's budget and the program. And so it makes sense to just come to you and say, I recommend that we extend the program and make it full day right now. You can see in your board packet that I have created a bulleted list of things that I've pulled together by talking to teachers, other administrators. We talked with the Parent Information Council on Friday. We've talked with various board committees, so that we have collected a lot of people's most recent thinking. And indeed, we believe that this will bring us, first of all, a more competitive kindergarten program. We're the only people left in the county with the half-day public school that has half-day. We believe that our parents will appreciate having a timely decision so that they can decide what to do with daycare if they know that it's going to be all-day kindergarten instead of part of a half day. We know that this will increase the instructional time for our students. And we have done some calculations, and we've talked with the kindergarten teachers about that. They are very excited to meet with me in January should we get a favorable vote from you. And we would begin to talk about what we want to do. We have lots of ideas that we've already gathered. We know that this would provide additional time not only for enrichment, but for the teachers to differentiate, especially for those non-title buildings that have at-risk students that we've talked about. We could add and add our complete science and social studies curriculums, which right now we do the best that we can on that, but with a half-day program, there isn't any way that the new core content standards are really covered in kindergarten. The kindergarten teachers were very excited and felt that it would be very beneficial for the children to have specialists in both art and music, which they currently don't have. We would be able to eliminate the need for parents to use schools of choice to get a full-day program for their students. although our extended day is not a full day program, it is an extended day for at-risk students. Our new program would be a full day program for all students as well. It would give our teachers, administrators, time to plan and intentionally prepare to provide training for the kindergarten teachers if they feel the need for any kinds of training. And it also then would protect us from this loss of funding. Should the intent legislation actually be pushed forward, we would not be in danger of losing half of our FTE for the kindergarten students. And finally, we recognize that if we have a full day kindergarten, the extended kindergartens would be eliminated. They have to be supplemental. We're using federal funds. So we have many ideas for how we would use that in a supplemental fashion, all of the Title I funding in different ways, just at the eligible buildings. And we would take a look at that as we do our needs assessment for next year. So what I'd like to do is recommend that to you this evening that we extend our half day to full day. And I'd like to provide the time for us to have input if other folks have any to give. And we'll come back in January and ask for action on that recommendation.
Thank you. Discussions or questions of Dr. Ellison?
Just a comment, I would say I think it's a great idea because we're being proactive. And if you know it's probably going to happen anyway, we need the extra time to plan. So good recommendation.
Yeah, this is something else that we talked at great length at FFO, and I'm a super strong supporter of it. I think it just makes good educational sense. And I think regardless of whether the legislation takes action or not, and we realize there's a financial risk, do we have the incremental cost or we wait and then we have diminished revenue, the bottom line is we're the only one in the district, in the county, that doesn't provide it. And I'd rather be differentiated by providing additional academic offerings than fewer academic offerings, quite frankly. And so we also stand at risk of losing students from that direction as well. So I think it makes total sense to do it. I would be very supportive of it when we're time to take action on it.
Yeah. Andy? I mean, I'm supportive of it now. I just know that back when my children were in kindergarten, it would have been a hard sell for me at the time. You know what I mean? Thinking of them being so little and going all day. But I think once people are into that mode, it will seem like the norm, you know, versus back when my kids were going to kindergarten, some schools had it and others didn't. And I thought, oh, I can't imagine sending them all day. So, but I can definitely see all the benefit to it.
Well, we're very sensitive to that and we'll be working with people to understand that and help them through that.
I just remember a positive when we were talking to Mrs. Willannon and visited the kindergarten classroom, and she was saying how the kindergarten teachers are just so pressured to get everything done in those couple hours, and you know, they feel bad because kids just have to move so fast and they don't get downtime and learning through playtime and recess and all those kinds of things that are so important for learning and their development. So from that aspect, it's I can see where they're excited. They won't feel the pressure and they feel that it's in the best interest of the kids. So it could be exciting.
Think about over time, and you know better than us, I mean, over the years, how much preparation these kids have at that age through preschool and Montessori and all kinds of other alternatives that way back when we didn't have those alternatives. So it seems like it's a natural kind of transition. Kids that have been, you know, going other places for a year or two anyways.
Actually, the Great Start Readiness Program, for those of you who've been on the board a long time and remember when we brought it on, it was first called Michigan Readiness Programs, and then it changed. But they have a lot of support currently politically in the governor, from the governor's office. So there's a lot going on in the preschool realm as well. And of course, we work with through the ESA at the county level with our Great Start program with Alan Oman running that. So it's very different now because of the preschools and the structure of the preschools. And interestingly, with the new core content core standards, there's a lot going on in education now talking about the preservation of the idea of play and developmental nature for the preschool, and that we all need to be careful that we're not doing away with that just because they would happen to be in school all day. It's not, you know, what we would like to get away from is this pressure to do so much, and let's just do well what we can do with the time we have without having that pressure be translated to our youngest students.
Just to add on to what you're saying is that I've seen some of the efforts with the Great Start Collaborative. Mm-hmm. Alan Oman is doing some work on that. There's actually some grant funding there for the Early Threes program. And then one thing was brought up to us in the CAS meeting is that, will parents really understand how, in the past, if they have older children that went through kindergarten that maybe started when they were 4 and a half or later, if parents can understand maybe how a full day can be a little bit hard on a 4-year-old compared to a 5-year-old. And so I know that that's one thing that it'd be nice if parents understood how that could be different for a child, maybe one of their younger child starting out in kindergarten, as opposed to the other kids that went through with a half a day. So hopefully parents understand a little bit about that, maybe being a challenge that parents aren't used to seeing. And so the other thing I was going to ask is that with having, sometimes we look in terms of building capacity, in terms of enrollment numbers or section capacity, and I looked at some of the report numbers, and it looks like we do have room to have all the sections for kindergarten. What is that going to look like in the buildings as far as lunchroom use and use, because now they have some physical education, art, and things like that. I'm sure you've got recommendations from the building principals and so forth. How's that going to look?
We have. The principals have spoken about that at principal meeting, and they've come forward with a plan. You know, for the next year or so, it might be a little bit tight, but we also know that with the shrinking enrollment and with continued shrinking sections, that's only going to be alleviated in the future. So I think everyone believes that that's doable and that we'll be able to find ways to get the lunch in, to get the gym classes in, and make everything happen.
Yeah. And go ahead.
Oh, I'm sorry. Well, we did have, you were mentioning about age, and we've also had some reminders that there's also discussion in our legislative branch that they might change the date. And okay. We don't really know whether they'll do that or not.
To parents.
But that's going to be quite tricky the year that it happens. But then from then on, it would be, you know, the right cycle. And a couple of folks asked what we thought that would mean to us. And I think we'll just have to get through the year of the transition by being sensitive, by differentiating, by working with people from their individual children and making that happen. I don't have any inside information about whether it's happening or not. We just know that that's something else and that would impact the kindergarten students.
Okay. And so when I looked at some of the figures and the projections for the kindergartners, it looks like that's going to stabilize a little bit. So if we have full day kindergarten, there's going to be some additional pressure in the buildings. But that's going to stabilize. I don't know if we're really going to go down by a number of sections throughout the buildings. You know, if you go down by maybe 40 students, it's only maybe 6 or 7 students per building. So would that really translate into decreasing sections? And what I wonder is that sometimes you may have a more full third grade, fourth grade. Is that going to be harder to add a section at the other grade levels if the buildings are pretty packed?
Do you have any feedback on the buildings? The principals really felt that it was doable, is what I can tell you. They've looked at their buildings. Okay. They think they can shift people to have the right rooms available.
Yeah. Right, and obviously, as they look towards next year, they can migrate students from one grade to the next, have a pretty good feel for that. What comes in at the summer, et cetera, that will be different. Also, you'll find that we'll have some leveling off of our kindergarten population. Currently, we get quite a few schools of choice, East Lawn and Carpenter, but it's an extended day. Many of those students are their siblings, their younger siblings that are coming towards kindergarten, that will even off, they will go back to their home school district. So I think what you'll see is, as far as the kindergarten goes, is that actually even out a little bit more. Our other grades, we have a pretty good feel for what those are. We could pick up some additional sections, but we could also lose sections because there are a few schools in which we have enough to justify another section, but with the loss of some, we may not. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Our principals feel pretty confident. We've been discussing this now for about 2.5 months, looking at their buildings, looking at what rooms they have available and what's projected as far as total number of sections next year. And remember, with schools of choice, we can always control how many sections go into an individual kindergarten at an individual building for those people who do want to move between buildings, maybe not because of extended day, but because of other reasons.
And that last point, John, is something that we've had a long history of having to do anyway. For example, remember when we went through the building consolidation, we were able to tell the Woodcrest parents that this school year there would be one section less, and in part that was, plus we told we were going to cut it off at the number of kindergarten sections. We weren't going to let that grow
sure.
for school of choice.
Sure.
And so we always have to govern and where the flow of school of choice students would go from one building to another. We'll just have to continue with that and watch it. Your point's well taken. We don't want to create a problem.
Right.
You know, do this and then create a problem that we hadn't anticipated, but we feel it's manageable.
Yeah, and so what I'm hearing is that school of choice, at least for kindergarten, won't be what it is. So you could have older siblings that have been gone into it, tracked into an elementary school that younger siblings may not be able to go into?
Well, typically, we try not to create a building that splits families. That's okay. been okay. also part of the past practice.
I could just see the sensitivity to that with a lot of the young families.
Yeah. I'd also point out that, for example, this past summer, we ended up having to add two kindergarten sections because of growth during the summer, et cetera, but those were at East Lawn and Carpenter, and they were probably directly tied to them having the
full day.
Yep. And then we got other students who came in beyond that.
Okay. In fact, I've heard the principal at East Lawn talk about that. She says they have about 29 schools of choice, so if they return, there is a section. Now, and they would be dispersed in the other schools, so everyone's not going to get a section. They'll get a few students.
Right.
One thing I found from my tenure on the board, and I think that, and Carl just alluded to this, we're always sensitive to the fact that older siblings have started in a school and a family wishes to continue in that process, that we've made accommodations for those needs. And I think that, you know, we will continue in that vein as we move forward. Great discussion, great questions. I have a warm fuzzy, though. And I listened to all this good dialogue and questions, but I've had several parents, and I know it's going to be hard to believe that I have friends who have children this age, but I do. They're very pleased with the idea that we were thinking about it, and now that this is before us for consideration next month, there'll be a lot of happy young parents in the community that have children this age, but they're very excited about the opportunity of having an all-day kindergarten in our district. So.
And another thing they're very happy about is that we would decide early enough so that they can make decisions.
Absolutely. Well, and I think it'll
better
informed, but also I think it goes to how well we want to be prepared as a district. And Carl and I talked about this, and we do have meetings and have breakfast. But we also talk about business, and we talked about how we as a district want to be the best prepared as we can be. And moving forward, if this in fact is supported by the board in next month's action, so that not only do we inform parents, but we are ready to go and hit the ground running, so to speak, in the fall with these new sections of all-day kindergarten. So great discussion and great questions.
Can I just a clarification? Are we planning to take action on this at the organizational meeting?
Yes.
Okay.
There'll be two separate, the organizational meeting and a business meeting
okay.
that will follow.
All right. Sorry. I just don't want to wait any longer than
that. We're going to get your assignments for the year, and we'll have some, and then we'll move into a separate agenda that same day. And as a reminder, and I'll say it again before the end of the meeting, that starts at 4 o'clock that day. So if you haven't cleared your calendars, please do so. Great discussion.
And we're not starting at 4 o'clock, so we can go until 9:30.
That's correct.
Thank you.
Generally, the organizational meeting is a shorter meeting.
Like 15 minutes. Yeah.
We would anticipate that...
Okay, don't laugh. I asked him. Okay. I didn't know.
I wasn't going to say that, Angela.
But being the new person, Angela, we understand.
Right.
We've asked those questions before in the past. So.
You'll be out by 10.
Yeah.
No problem.
So, and with that, we'll move on to Mrs. Klein on Senate Bill 7 and the presentation of this information.
Yes, and this is actually Public Act 152 of 2011. It began its life as Senate Bill 7, but once it became legislation, it's now a public act. And there's been a lot of discussion around this, as well as a great deal of misunderstanding. And so tonight I hope to clarify for you what it is, how it affects us, and what we might want to consider as we move forward. First is an explanation of what the bill is. It limits what governments, not just schools, but what any local government in Michigan, state or local government, may pay for employee medical benefits. So it applies purely to medical, and that includes pharmacy, but does not apply to dental or vision or any of the other insurance benefits. And it does not specify how much employees must contribute toward the cost of those medical benefits. There seems to have been a bit of a misunderstanding that there's something in the law that requires employees to pay a particular percentage. You might infer that from the way it's written, but that is not what it says. And it certainly does not require employees to pay 20% of their salary, which is something that we've heard a little bit of internally. There seems to be a great deal of concern around that. For us, Midland Public Schools, it's going to take effect on January 1, 2012, and that is because that is the beginning of our medical plan year. The way it's written is it takes effect at the beginning of the plan year that begins on or after January 1, 2012. So for us, it will go into effect then. And it has two different ways of calculating a limit, and in a minute I'll show you how those affect Midland Public Schools. But the first is the default. If you take no action, a hard cap will go into effect for the district that will limit the amount that we may pay throughout the calendar year 2012. We still have a lot of questions about how the state is going to verify that we have complied with this law. We don't really know the details of that, but what we do know is that the law says we'll calculate our number of employees receiving single coverage times $5,500 per year plus those with employee plus one coverage times $11,000 per year plus those with family coverage times $15,000 per year, and that will establish a cap that the district may not pay beyond. The remaining amount must be paid by the employees, and the law specifically states that it is the local government's decision how that amount is going to be allocated across the employees. Now, because the law did not also amend PARA, the Public Employee Relations Act, certainly sections of this are subject to bargaining. So it's not just a unilateral decision on the part of the board. So that's the default. No action means that's what goes into effect for the district. There is a provision that with a majority vote of the board, you can limit the amount that the district would pay to 80% of the illustrative rate. And because we're self-funded, we have an illustrative rate rather than a premium. The law refers to either one. But the illustrative rate is set each year. It's based on our claims experience, the cost of our stop-loss insurance, and it determines a quasi-premium cost for each of those different categories. And because our favorable experience last year, our illustrative rate actually went down for calendar year 2012. It's lower than it had been for 2011. And we are quite a bit lower than we were even back in 2007. So because we don't have a straight premium-based insurance plan, our illustrative rate bounces up and down as a result of our claims. There's not a linear sense of growth there. And both of these decisions, either the hard cap or the 80-20, refer to our illustrative rate, so you'll see that in a minute. So I want to start by showing you what our current situation is. And for we, of course, collect premiums from our employees on a fiscal year, so it's hard to say what this will look like for calendar year 2012 because we haven't established those rates for the next fiscal year. But in our current year, our administrators, our pay, and our building managers, our unaffiliates, and the support staff, MSESPA, that would be our grounds and maintenance people, are all paying a percent of salary. And we chose that in lieu of a flat amount because it appeared to us to be more equitable. Those with higher incomes are paying a higher percent of the cost of their plan than those with lower amounts. We have some people who work only a portion of the year and perhaps not even 40 hours, but they qualify for benefits for at least a portion of that time. Their annual income is not particularly high, and if we had just done a straightforward across-the-board percent of the cost of the plan, we felt that those people would be unduly punished, paying a much higher share than those with the higher incomes. So for this current year, administrators, depending on their level of coverage, are paying anywhere from 1 3/4 to 3% of salary. And the estimate for the size of that group is about $104,000. And at the 2012 illustrative rate, that is about 26% of the amount. Now, what is budgeted is not necessarily the illustrative rate. In fact, you'll see on the next slide, what's budgeted for this year is quite a bit higher than the new illustrative rate came in. Building managers, you can see, are paying anywhere from 6.55% to 7.8% of their salary. And they opted to do that in lieu of a reduction of their salary equivalent to 1 month of pay. You may remember back when we were setting the 2011-12 budget, there was a lot of discussion about whether building managers should be reduced to working 11 months rather than 12 months. They felt that this was probably a better choice for them, so they are paying a very large share, and their contribution for a relatively small group is $31,000 and averages about 33% of the illustrative rate. The other unaffiliates took a 2.5% pay decrease, as did the building managers, but they kept their percentages at the same levels that we had established in 2010-11, 0.75%, 1.5%, or 2%. And for that group, it's about $52,000 of contribution, or approximately 6% of the illustrative rate, which is equivalent to what it is for the grounds and maintenance staff who are members of MSESPA. And at this time, because we don't have a settled contract with teachers and paraprofessionals, we're in negotiations with each of those groups. There is no contribution at this point. So for the groups that are contributing, the total is $194,000, our estimate, and that's about 3% of the total illustrative rate. Before I go on, are there questions on current situation?
Is that 3% of all employees or just the people that are contributing?
That's 3% of the total illustrative rate for the district.
For the district?
Yes. What you see for each of the individual groups is the amount that they're contributing toward their particular share of the cost.
And that group of employees up there that was making a contribution, on average, what would you say, what percent of the district does that represent of total number of employees, like 10-20%?
We have, that's probably about 20%, 20 maybe 25% of all covered employees that are contributing there. Now, I should say before we go on that there is a significant penalty in this law for noncompliance. Again, I said we're not sure how the state's going to monitor this, but the penalty is 10% of our state aid.
Wow.
If they found it for, yes. Enough to get our attention.
Ouch. Yeah.
They know how to incentivize.
Something
they?
On the neighborhood of over $5 million. So it's serious. This is nothing to take lightly. But we believe that at this point we are in compliance, and here's why. Here's our comparison of our alternatives. You can see as of November we had 68 employees receiving single coverage, and this is district-wide. And this does have to apply district-wide. You're not permitted to have a different plan in place for different employee groups. This is what the district will pay in aggregate. We had 120 employees who are covered with one dependent, maybe their spouse, maybe a dependent, and then 385 employees with family coverage. The cap is, as I mentioned, $5,500, $11,000, and $15,000. Our illustrative rate for this year is actually below what the cap is. Now, last year, 2011, our illustrative rates were higher, and the single rate exceeded the cap. However, in aggregate, we still were below the cap. So we would have still been in compliance with the law. So to calculate the cap, we multiply 68 times 5,500, 120 times 11,000, 385 times 15,000. And you can see that the maximum that the district would be permitted to pay would be $7,469,000. We're well under that with our illustrative rate of $6,311,128. If we look at the 80%, 20%, calculates a little bit differently. The maximum that the district could pay would be $5,048,903. And $1,262,225 would need to be spread across the employees in some manner. Now, interestingly, our actual budget for this year is just a little over $7 million. And that was based on taking our last year's actual performance, applying medical and pharmacy trends to it, and seeing what that created. Now, we have had good experience most recently of coming in under budget. But if we go back a few years, we'll see that that's not always the case. But we're on target right now. We're doing well. We do not recommend to you at this time that you take any action. We recommend that you allow the hard cap to go into effect. And the reasoning is because since we are currently in negotiations, we have no assurance for you that we'll be able to reach that 20%. When the new year starts in another couple of weeks. And that does not mean that you're back up here prevented from doing what we're already doing. It does not mean that we're not permitted to capture premium contributions from employees. It just means that we're going to specify to the state that we're going to allow the hard cap to take effect, and we don't have to worry about whether we will be able to hit that 20% target or not. I think it's worth noting, too, that the hard caps are supposed to increase each year by the rate of medical inflation as measured by the Consumer Price Index, and our illustrative rates fluctuate somewhat. And at some point, the tipping point for the district, right now it appears that the 80-20 would be a better plan for us. However, at some point, if our illustrative rate were to exceed the cap by 25%, it would then serve the district better to maintain the hard cap. We would actually collect more under the hard cap than we would under the 80%. So at the moment, certainly the 80% would serve us better budgetarily, but we have no reason to believe that we can hit that target. We don't want to put ourselves at risk of losing the state aid in case we are not able to get there. And we do know that at some point in the future, the hard cap would be in the best interest of the district. So in a nutshell, that's where we are with Public Act 152 or Senate Bill 7.
Question, John. Just have a question. At the present time, we're able to meet the requirements. We're getting close to meeting all the requirements for the dashboard.
For the best practices.
Best
money.
Practices, and yes. So forth, the 4 out of the 5 or 5 out of the 6. So no matter what alternative we go with, we're still going to be the owner of the policy, and that wouldn't really affect what
right.
We do.
The one best practice that we won't meet is the one that requires every employee, not just across the district, but every employee to contribute 10% of the cost of all their benefits combined. So that would be each employee contributes 10% of their medical, their dental, their vision, their accidental death, disability, all of
that's the one we're having the most trouble
with. That one we won't meet.
Okay.
But the other four, I believe we will.
Okay. Question? Yeah, John.
Rick? So if through negotiations an agreement was reached that would result in the teachers contributing towards their health care, you feel, given that could be a wide range of where we'd end up, you feel pretty comfortable that we'd be protected and then we're covered by the direction we're headed now, given those what ifs.
For 2012, yes.
Okay.
But just to be clear, as it stands right now, if we go with the default, which we will, which is the hard cap, there's really no effect on anybody.
Correct.
I mean, compared to where you are right now, nobody will be paying any more. Those that are paying zero will continue to pay zero. Those that are paying the percentages
right.
listed will pay those percentages.
Yes.
So it has. So the rumors we're hearing and people are talking to us about would not be going into effect. People don't have to pay 20% of their salary for health care with the hard cap.
Absolutely not.
Okay.
Yeah.
No.
It's amazing how often you hear that.
A lot in the last week or so.
We're going to be forced to pay 20%. I hear it all the time.
It was never true that people would have to pay 20% of their salary to cover their health care costs. Right. I mean, that was a misnomer from the very beginning. So there's a fair amount of misinformation out there. Tell me if I misstate this, Linda. I like to look at ranges. I mean, depending on what your income is here, we have a fair number of employees that are paying between $3,000, even $4,500 a year for their health care coverage, some employees. That amount, to me, is less important. And Linda mentioned this earlier. When you look at some of our lower paid staff, the unaffiliated staff and so on, that are paying particularly the building managers, mm-hmm. they have really made the largest contribution to helping the district maintain its financial stability than any other employee group. Yeah. I mean, clearly that is true. But it's pretty significant to know that you have a range of as low as, you know, what, $1,000 or $500 for some of our lower paid staff and others that are paying $4,500 a year.
That's right.
That's a significant concession that other employees have given this district.
Good point.
The only employees for whom it might be true that they would have to pay 20% of salary would be those whose annual wages is very close to the cost of family coverage, and they're mm-hmm. happening to receive family coverage. That's why we feel better about handling it the way we have as a percent of wages, because for that group, they could truly be in a position of having to pay close to 20% of their salary.
Okay.
Yeah, I agree. I think it's been a very good approach.
Any other questions or discussion? Thank you, Linda. Great information, and I think it clears the air a little bit with respect to what's really happening out there. And moving from that to the next piece of finance is also yours.
Our favorite part, gifts. And these have all been processed. They are under the $5,000 threshold. They total $6,621. The first is from the Dow High Music Parents, and they have annually provided support for a choir accompanist at HH Dow High School. Woodcrest PTO has made a donation in a couple of different areas, and then the Laura Luddington Hollenbeck Foundation has provided support for a Holocaust field trip for the students at Central. And none of these require your approval at this point, just for information.
Thank you. And with that, we have no study report from the Human Resource Committee, so we'll move on to Mr. Valendi.
Thank you. We have three memoriams. Mr. Robert Miner passed away on November 22nd, worked with Midland Public Schools in the grounds department for 32 years. He retired in 1997. And also our sympathies go out to the family of Mrs. Helen Campbell, who passed away on the 26th of November. She was a Title I counselor and was awarded the Gerstacker Teacher Proficiency Award in 1973. She worked for 23 years with Midland Public Schools, retiring in 83. And lastly, Mrs. Edith Holmes, who passed away on November 28th. She was a teacher at Longview Elementary School, and she worked for 28 years with us, retiring in 1992.
Thank you, and our condolences to their families. Before we get too far into this, I'm going to mention to the studio or the audience here at the Administrative Service Center that we will be going into a closed session after this. And I want to remind the board members as well. So in the next piece, and thanks, Gary, correspondence to and from the Board of Education, scheduled activities. Again, a reminder to the board that we have an organizational meeting on January 9th, 2012 at 4 p.m. in this building. In addition to that, an agenda that will, where we will conduct some school business and take action on Dr. Ellison's recommendation for all-day kindergarten. So with that.
And potentially the property management plan.
That's correct. I'm sorry. Yeah, property management plan. I know, and it may be others before we get there, but there'll be definitely an agenda that evening in addition to the organizational meeting. In addition to that, you have the regularly scheduled board meeting dates scheduled through June 25th, 2012. And so with that, I'm going to open it up for study discussion, but just prior to that, you have all in before you a yellow piece of paper.
Purple.
Yellow?
Or, I'm sorry. It was a Perry moment. Anyway, it's purple, and I'm not colorblind. If you'd be so kind as to fill that out and put these up here for Linda to make tabulation. That's for a...
Myths or Alfred, that's why it's that color.
Yeah, it must be. It's for the committee to make the recommendation for slate of officers for next year. And so I see that you all have taken care of that very nicely, so thank you. You have, if you haven't filled out, and I know that Angela's still digesting this as the newest board member, but you also have turned in your Board of Education Committee assignment request forms, which is great. And I have a proxy from Jerry, so we're moving forward, and we'll have everything ready for our meeting in January. So now, even though the color was purple and it was not yellow, I will start to my right with Dr. Kaminsky on study discussion.
Okay, thank you, Ken. 2 weekends ago, I attended a great event at Delta College. Next year in Delta College, fund and support the Ready Set Lego tournament. I know it doesn't seem like it's all that real sophisticated, but it was actually amazing for elementary kids and middle school kids to have a task, have a challenge, and use robotics built with Legos to solve that problem, and to see the kids really excited about their team logos and mascots. They're wearing funny hats and really into the spirit. And to see these kids spend so much time on a weekend getting involved in math and science and using laptop computers to program these little Lego robots that moved across to a sort of a tournament little mat and field, it was just amazing. It was about 500 kids that attended that. And we had three teams from Midland, and it was just amazing talking to the coaches, say, why have the high school robotics students mentor these kids? Why have the clubs? And it was just amazing in how somebody who works at Dow Chemical, has a science background, said that it's just amazing in how these kids at the elementary and middle school level can take and come up with a solution that doesn't exist and use science and technology. I think it was just amazing to see that. And a few of the coaches said they appreciated MPS for allowing space to practice that. I know that they practiced for about 6 months starting in the fall, and they were able to use some of the space, so a lot of late hours using MPS buildings and space, and they're very appreciative of that. And congratulations to Northeast Middle School student Madison Tarnowski. She won the International Lions Peace Poster contest. Mr. Pools organized that and got the middle school level students competing in that, and so we appreciate doing that. And ironically, it's a nice message at this time of year, and also with what's going on in the district. Her theme for her poster was unity, which is really inspiring from our students. So thank you to Steve Poole for getting that together, and congratulations to Madison. And just lastly, I just wanted to end my comments with being thankful at this time of year for something that we don't have, and that's mid-year cuts coming with program reductions, layoffs, and things like that. This is really my second time through this season, and it's nice. I'm sure the budget's not going to be any more pleasant coming up in the spring, but I'm really thankful for that we don't have to look at cuts and mid-year reductions. So, on to Lynn.
Okay. Well, so I don't forget, I want to thank Plymouth School and Mason in particularly. We all received beautiful Christmas cards once again. And those are always a highlight of the Christmas season. So thank you to all our students that participated in that. And I also see here that a graduate of Siebert Ellis Elementary is an author that is going to be in town for a book signing at Dow Gardens. And one of the books, Lost in the Woods, I actually have purchased. And it is a year or two ago. And I didn't realize that was one of his books, so I'm looking forward to maybe getting over to Dow Gardens to check that out. We have so many talented students and graduates. And today I just happened to be talking to someone at the Midland Community Center, and I just wanted to mention this because we really haven't talked about it a lot this year, the middle school sports and just the comments that things are going really, really well. And from her perspective, and she has a child that's involved. And just so that we don't forget that it's the programs are up and they're running. They're just being run by a different entity. And but many of our coaches are the same. And we appreciate all the people that are involved in supporting that program and the leadership of Midland Community Center and anyone else that's involved. And let's see. Well, we saw tonight that there's a lot of discussion and decisions that'll be made at the beginning of the year. Thank you to Carl and the staff for the property management, and Kathy with the upcoming kindergarten program, and Linda with the upcoming insurance issues. So there's always decisions on the horizon. So I'm with John. We don't see. I am very grateful after all these years not to have to face difficult reduction decisions mid-year, but we have some that are kind of exciting decisions that we'll be making after the first of the year. And I hope everyone enjoys all the holiday activities that are going on in the schools and has a wonderful, wonderful Christmas and a Christmas break.
Mrs. Rouse.
So my last comments, again, I just wanted to thank all of you for all of your support and giving me the opportunity to serve. I made my quick little what I won't miss and what I'll miss list, and I just thought I'd share it with you really quick. You know, I won't miss meetings that go till midnight or FFO meetings that go till 11 o'clock, but I will miss the exchange of ideas, because I think you're a pretty amazing board. And you all give so much of your thoughts and ideas and attention, and I'll miss that. I will not miss reading the tax resolutions. So somebody else will get a chance to do that. But I will miss handing out diplomas, because I think that's just a rare treat for board members. And I'm so honored to have been able to give one to my daughter and many of my friends' siblings and neighbors' siblings and their daughters and sons, so that I think that's something that we all get. That's just a wonderful thing to have an opportunity to do. I certainly won't miss the uncertainty of funding, but hopefully I'll be able to help you in a different way around that. I will miss seeing all the amazing things that our students do and our staff does too, because there's not a single meeting that doesn't go by when we aren't giving some accolades to somebody. So That's special, and it's neat to be able to see that every month. And finally, I will not miss making all those gut-wrenching decisions that kind of keep you up at night and give you all those stress maladies that many of us have had. But I'll be thinking about you all as you do that. So I will miss all of you and all the dedication that you have given through the years and that you'll continue to do. So I just wish you all, everybody, staff, board, everybody the best of luck and wishes. So happy holidays.
Thank you, Lane.
Real quickly, I just wanted to comment again how supportive I am and enthusiastic I am about the all-day kindergarten. And I think among many reasons, one of the reasons I'm really excited about it is that it seems for many years we've been kind of in this mode of reducing and cutting and changing, not necessarily always in a positive way as much as we'd like to do it. And this is an example where we're going to add services. We're going to add educational services, and it's kind of refreshing, quite frankly, to be able to do that for good reasons. And just lastly, I just want to make a comment about Lee, and I just can't resist. You know, all those characteristics I talked about before, 8 or 10 of them, when you all put them together and you mix them all up, what you get out of it is leadership. And in the holiday season, we talk about gifts a lot. And yet, we all have gifts, and I'm saying we all have gifts in the form of talents and experiences. We all bring gifts to the table. And I'm just really thankful that she has given us the gift of her leadership for 8 years.
Thank you.
Angela.
My turn. Well, let's see. I actually have a few things tonight. First, I really did not get to know you, Lee, too much. But I must say, being on the school closing committee, I did have a lot of respect for you and the way that you led the entire board through that.
Thank you.
And I know it was very tough for you and all of you.
And all of you on the committee, too.
Yeah. And secondly, there are a couple of gentlemen out here in the audience. I had the opportunity last week to sit down with some Midland High students for their, I think, correct me if I'm wrong, 0.4 government class. So I actually went through about six of them, and we sat around someone's kitchen table, and we talked, and it was, I think, probably one of the nice experiences we get to have is being on the board, and great job you guys staying this whole time. You should have come to the last meeting. Not earlier.
She's learning quickly.
And I'm sadly tonight, this is another thing of this job, missing my daughter's orchestra concert, so rather sad about that, but I'm sure that it went well for all the Jefferson Orchestra students tonight. And then I wish everyone a happy holiday, and I hope everyone is safe if you're traveling. Thank you.
Thank you all, and really well said, and you know, it's always, and I've said it before, difficult to be last, but I'll start off with a meeting that I think that brings at least a little bit of holiday spirit with respect to having a meeting with our legislators last week. Lee and I and Jerry Wasserman joined Carl at the ESA, and the tempo in Lansing, at least from that meeting, to me, feels like it slowed down somewhat, which is a good thing. They are proceeding with the personal property tax issue, but very slowly and deliberate, which is good for us and good for our community. How that outcome will look, I'm not sure yet, but at least it's not a rush to resolve another tax issue without looking at it more deeply in a very conscientious way. And so I commend both of our legislators that were able to be with us and share that with us. And so that was a very good meeting and good, another early morning for all of us, and as well as Carl. And so wanted to report back on that. To our young students who are not so young, I mean high schoolers that are here tonight, you picked, as Angela has stated, you picked the wrong meeting to come to, but it's a good learning experience. And so thank you again for not bailing on us. Carl, just, you know, I don't think that we say this often enough. This guy is everywhere. I mean, and I don't think we give him credit until we have his annual review on his yearly progress. But, you know, we're in, you know, it's like his discussion and the tenure with Lee as president and my tenure as president, we talk a lot. And if it's not every day, it seems like it's every day. And so there's a lot that he's involved with, and he's always on the cutting edge of what we're doing along with the agenda group and making sure that we're not only in compliance, but, you know, talking about what's the best benefit with respect to our district and our students' educational experience moving forward. I knew about the Central Middle School meeting today before the Central Middle School meeting occurred, and that's important to me. And it's as well as it is to Carl and the staff there. And I think that's the kind of communication that I really appreciate. And again, thanks, Carl. So I don't think we say that enough. Calendar, if you, for those board members who haven't, I don't know if it's out in the hallway, but I'm sure we can get copies for those. If you haven't seen a holiday musical at any of our high school or schools, you still have time, okay? It's not only did Angela's event this evening at that she missed at Jefferson going on, but there's events all the way up to the 22nd of this month. So if you want a quality experience with any number of our buildings, please look at that schedule. To my last point before I move on to the ballot that we just cast with respect to the selection committee, Lee, I'm going to miss you. I guess there's no other way to say it. You are a champion for all students who go to our district and receive a quality education. And that was always the fiber in which you based your decisions on. And that's hugely important for we as board members sitting here. As Carl alluded to, it's not the pay. You know, you get zero from zero, and it's for the love of young people, and we really appreciate your time here. So thank you again. So before moving on to Mr. Ellinger, I will tell you that the ballot results are in, and joining me on the nominating committee will be Mr. Oley and Mr. Wasserman. So with that, Mr. Ellinger.
Four recognitions for building and students. We like to end our meetings by taking the focus back to the students that we serve. Northeast Middle School sixth grade teacher, also the first one's not a staff member, pardon me. Ms. Linda Doran was chosen Big Sister of the Year. She was chosen by the staff of the Big Brother, Big Sister organization. Mrs. Doran has been a Big Sister for 17 years, if you can believe that or not. During that time, she has had three long-term little sisters, with the last one lasting 7.5 years. Linda is committed and dedicated to this very special program, so that's worthy of special recognition, let me tell you. Congratulations to the Dow High Novice Debate Team, who recently won the Novice State Debate Tournament. This is the fourth time that Dow High School has won the Novice State Championship, with the last win in 2008-09. Congratulations to the H.H. Dow High School Symphonic Band and their band director, Mr. Steve DeReese, for being selected to perform at the Michigan Music Conference held at the DeVos Place and Amway Grand Hotel in Grand Rapids. The band will be performing on Friday, January 20th at 3:15, in case any of our community members want to go. And I understand there's quite a crew, maybe even a bus full. This very high honor is awarded to only the best performing ensembles in the state after a long audition process, which takes into consideration a history of consistent Division I ratings at the MSBO festivals, recommendations from adjudicators, and a sound recording. Steve has been the director of the Dow High Band for 17 years and is assisted by Nikki Bruski. Past directors of this proud tradition of performance there at Dow High School are Floyd Mead, Gary Burgess, and of course Jim Huber most recently. And then back to students, congratulations to Zoe Peeler, who designed the winning window in the annual Circus Business Association Holiday Window Contest. Zoe was honored at a reception last Thursday. You can see Zoe's window display at Smith Flowers if you care to look that up during this holiday season. So great things happening on behalf of our students. Thank you for being here. We hope to read about you in the future.
Okay, before we end this evening, I will take a motion to move into closed session.
So moved.
What would be your last motion?
Moved by Mrs. Rouse, supported by Mr. Oley. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Roll call, Kim.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Sorry.
Roll call.
Yep. All right. Mount.
Yes.
Rouse, yes. Oley.
Yes.
Baker.
Yes.
Branstad.
Yes.
Kaminsky.
Yes. We have a motion and it has passed. We will take a 5-minute recess and move into closed session.